Let's start. Today we will start equatorial oceanography. So we're looking at what's called the equatorial beta plane. Now these are the equations that we have. Ut minus Fp plus Px equals tau x by h that we have designated as f. Vt plus Fu plus Py equals tau y by h that is g is the meridional wind stress. And Pt by C squared plus Ux plus By equals 0. So this is what we have been seeing all along in this course. And this is done for each vertical model. We have dropped the subscript in for convenience. Now, you have F here multiplying U and B in these two equations. The problem at the equator is that F is 2 omega sine theta. And it changes much more rapidly than in the mid latitudes when you come close to the equator, because the rate of change of F is given by cos theta, proportional to cos theta, and cos theta decreases as you go farther away from the equator. It has its maximum value at the equator. So the rate of change of F is much less in the mid latitudes than it is at the equator. So this is the major change that occurs when we move from the mid latitudes to the equator. F can no longer be assumed constant. Now what we did in the mid latitude case is we said F is F naught plus beta y whenever we wanted to use the beta plane, and wherever we had to differentiate F we wrote beta, but wherever we didn't differentiate we assumed it to be constant. That is how we were able to solve the system of equations. But near the equator that's no longer possible because F is simply beta y, F naught goes to 0. So the only way out for us is to do something different, and what we do is the following. Now within 30 degrees of the equator, roughly plus minus 30 degrees, the sine function describing F can be linearized, because the sine function is given by, if you take sine theta, it is theta minus theta cubed by 3 factorial and so on. Now, as long as theta is small and approximation is not bad till about 30 degrees, then we can linearize. We can assume that sine theta is nearly theta. And that leads us to what's called the equatorial beta plane, in which F is simply beta 1. Okay. Now I have here some plots that would be of interest. Let me see if I have kept copies. So this is a plot that they were asked to make. I don't think this is the right one. No. Don't have soft copies of this picture. Okay. Fine. I'll see if I can get this. But if you ask any of those students who took the junior math course in 2011 and 12, they'll be able to show you plots of sine theta for different values of theta, and for the truncation at different terms. So how far you can go with sine theta equals theta and so on. It's clear that by the time you reach theta equals 2 pi, you need a pretty large number of terms. I think it was 9 or 17, something like that. I'm not very sure. But you can actually see the sine curve and how each of these approximations builds up. So till sine theta equals 30 degrees, it's theta equals 30 degrees, it's a pretty decent approximation. In the mid-latitude beta plane, we assumed f to be a constant except when it was differentiated. This assumption led to a differential equation with constant coefficients. And that is the reason we made this assumption. We set f to f naught except when it was being differentiated. Otherwise, we would have got a similar equation with variable coefficients, and it would not have been of much use. On the equatorial beta plane, we get a differential equation with variable coefficients. Beta f is beta y. Okay, so now we have to go through the same kind of approximations that we did in the case of the mid-latitudes, interior ocean, away from the equator and away from the continents. So let's start by saying that we replace dou by dou t plus a by c squared, which is our vertical mixing term, with I omega. Okay, so the a by c squared terms occur on the right hand side. And what we'll have here is I omega u minus fp plus px equals f, I omega v plus fu plus py equals g. And we'll set g to 0. We'll consider only zonal winds. Just as when we were looking at coast, we were considering longshore winds. And you have seen the reason why you don't bother about crossshore winds. It has practically no important significance. Likewise, at the equator, we look at zonal winds along the equator. And then we have I omega p by c squared plus ux plus vy equal to 0. You can solve these three to get a single equation for v. There are two terms here denoted by b and a, I omega vxx plus I omega cubed by c squared into v. Now these are in square brackets. And this is similar to the kind of terms we got when we were looking at the mid-latitudes, so except that there we had vxx plus vy. And we saw that there are conditions under which these two terms could be dropped in comparison with some other term. So we have these two terms, I omega vxx plus I omega cubed by c squared v plus I omega into, in brace brackets, an operator, dou yy minus f squared by c squared into v. Now, we had vyy in the mid-latitude case, and I omega vyy was no different in that case from I omega vxx, because it didn't matter to us whether we were looking at the x derivative or the y derivative. But now in the vicinity of the equator, since f is beta y, there is a distinction. Earlier we had minus I omega squared by c squared into v, but now we are going to look at this in a slightly different fashion. Plus beta vx equals I omega f by c squared into capital F minus capital F yx. So this part is similar to what we had earlier, except that if I remember right, in the mid-latitude case, we initially started by looking at both f and g, and then we picked the wind stress that we would consider. Now, if we ignore vt in the meridional momentum equation, we haven't done that so far, we get the following much simpler equation. I omega into this operator, dou yy minus f squared by c squared to v plus beta vx equals the right hand side. What happens is that terms a and b drop out. So that is the consequence of dropping vt in the meridional momentum equation. Now this is not different from what we had done earlier in the mid latitudes, and we found that you can ignore terms a and b in comparison to whatever term c was there, that was f squared by c squared into v in that case, under certain conditions. If certain conditions are fulfilled, then this neglect of vt is sensible. Otherwise, you can't do it. Now, terms a and b of the first equation are not present in the second equation. That's over here. This simplification will therefore hold if terms a and b are negligible in comparison to term c. Now, term c in this case is this operator, dou yy minus f squared by c squared v, of course, multiplied by omega, which we can factor out. Earlier, we were comparing with f squared by c squared. Now, we are comparing with this operator, because dou yy now is not something that we can treat on par with dou xx. That is the major change that takes place in the equatorial beta plane. To make this comparison, we need a measure of term c. Earlier, it was straightforward. You had f squared by c squared, and all you had to do was compare the other terms against f squared by c squared. But now you need a measure of what is this dou by y. You have f squared by c squared, but f goes to 0 at the equator. So how do you arrive at a measure of this term if you are to use it as a standard for comparing those terms a and b? Now, since f is beta y, f squared by c squared is beta squared y squared by c squared, and it turns out, we shall see this later, that an appropriate measure of term c is simply beta by c. So for now we will just assume that and go ahead, and later you will see that the algebra will show you that this is the appropriate scaling to use. It turns out, as we shall see later, that the relevant time scale for comparison is omega naught equals square root of beta c, and the relevant length scale is 1 by alpha naught equals square root of c by beta. Now there are some small changes here. Earlier the time scale was given by 1 by f or 2 pi by f, and that was the initial period at the latitude of interest. And the length scale was given by c by f, and that we set to 1 by alpha. Alpha for us was f by c. Now we have a subscript naught. We say omega naught and alpha naught, and the expressions are a little more complicated. Omega naught is square root of beta c, and 1 by alpha naught is square root of c by beta. Omega naught, we shall see this later, turns out to be the equatorial inertial frequency, the equivalent of f at mid latitudes, and 1 by alpha naught is the equatorial Rossby radius. In the mid latitudes we have c by f instead of square root of c by beta. So term A, which is 1 I omega cubed by c squared into V, if you compare with term C, I omega is common. So we basically have omega squared by c squared, and that you are comparing with the term here. Now, omega squared has two parts, one coming from dou by dou t, and the other coming from a by c squared. Dou by dou t is the time rate of change. So it gives you some kind of a time scale, the time scale associated with the acceleration, local acceleration. And a by c squared gives you a time scale that is associated with the friction, the vertical mixing time scale. Now, if 1 by t, that is, if t is the time scale associated with the phenomenon that we are studying, term A can be neglected if 1 by t is very much less than omega naught, or t is much greater than omega naught, 1 by omega naught, or 2 pi by omega naught, that would be the appropriate way to look at it. So if the time scale of interest to you, that is the rate of change, is such that the time scale associated with the local acceleration is much greater than the equatorial inertial period, then you can ignore one part of term A, that is the dou by dou t part. And you can ignore a by c squared part if a by c squared is much less than omega naught. So what you are saying then is that the time scale of the phenomenon is much greater than the equatorial inertial period, and the damping time scale is likewise much longer. So the time scale associated with the vertical mixing is also much longer than the local inertial period. Now, as seen at mid latitudes, here too the damping time scale decreases with increase in Mach number. Now there's one catch here. In this case, both the characteristic time scale and the characteristic length scale have seen them, and therefore depend on stratification. In the mid latitudes, the equivalent of omega naught was just f, and that was independent of stratification. But at the equatorial beta plane, that's not the case. Stratification is important. In both cases, you have C in the characteristic length scale. So stratification is important when you are talking in terms of the length scale and the time scale. But we know that C decreases as Mach number n increases. As the vertical Mach number increases, C is going to decrease. So if you look at A by C squared, there will be a high order mode for which a by c squared will become large enough, and this inequality will at some point no longer hold. So as seen at the mid latitudes, here too the damping time scale decreases with increase in mode number. A by c squared increases, and therefore the damping time scale decreases, and will eventually be greater than the equatorial inertial period for some high order mode. Should be lesser, lower than the equatorial inertial period for some high order mode. So another error. So as the mode number increases, at some point you will find that this approximation is going to break down. So you can no longer ignore this term. Likewise, square root of c by beta, it keeps decreasing as mode number increases. And what it implies is that when you compare for term B can be neglected if Lx is very much greater than 1 by alpha naught, that's square root of c by beta. That is the zonal length scale of the phenomenon, or the wavelength of the wave, or the zonal extent of the wind patch is much greater than the equatorial Rossby radius. Now, Lx is the length scale that we are interested in, but again you're comparing with square root of c by beta. So the critical thing here is the lower order mode, because the length scale is highest, the characteristic length scale for the first mode. As mode number increases, the length scale decreases. So it is unlikely that you will have a problem at high order modes if you do not have a problem at low order modes. So what are the numbers that you get? At the equator, beta is 2.3 into 10^-13 per centimeter per second. And if you set C to 230 centimeters per second, done to get simpler numbers here, then square root of beta C gives us about 10 days, the equatorial inertial period. Okay, square root of beta C is omega naught, but I've converted that to period here. Equatorial inertial periods of the order of 10 days. And square root of C by beta is of the order of 315 kilometers. That's the equatorial Rossby radius. So if your length scale is of the order of, say, 1,000 kilometers or more, which is very often the case for the kind of phenomena we'll be studying, then you could look at the simpler equation, dropping Vt. Similarly, if your local acceleration is such that you are describing the seasonal cycle, or even intra-seasonal variability of the order of maybe 80, 90 days, you could drop Vt. But it is clear that as you come to the Madden-Julian oscillation, for example, we are talking of the lower end, 30 to 80 days, so you're talking of, say, 30-day period, then the approximation is not necessarily as good. And there are waves at the equator, like Yannai waves, for which it breaks down completely. In typical periods of the order of 15 days or 25 to 30 days. And at 15 days, it's not much greater than 10. So the approximation does not hold. And Vt does turn out to be important for the Yannai wave. Note two points. First, there is no constraint on the meridional length scale. Earlier, we were comparing both Lx and Ly. Now we are not bothered about Ly anymore. We have a constraint only on the zonal length scale, Lx. Second, we don't neglect Ut, only Vt. In the mid-latitude case, we often look for solutions in which we ignore both Ut and Vt. And that's not something we do here. We ignore only Vt, we have to retain Ut. This retention of Ut is a consequence of F vanishing at the equator. So at the equator, you actually have a similarity. That variable coefficient goes to zero. This implies that cross-equatorial geostrophy is not possible. Only along equatorial geostrophy is possible. This is the equivalent of along-shore geostrophy. You can assume along-shore geostrophy, or its equivalent here is along equatorial geostrophy, assuming you treat the equator as a coast. And it's not a bad term to use. But you cannot assume cross-equatorial geostrophy in the sense that if we cannot be equated to Px. So this term Ut is retained to avoid singularities at the equator. Basically, as F comes close to zero, it is no longer possible to ensure that the local accelerations are going to be small. So you can have much more rapid response at the equator, and as we shall see, even the waves they propagate much faster as you come closer to the equator. We know that the Rossby wave speed, for example, grows as 1 by y squared. And we know that if we come close to the equator, the closer we come to the equator, the higher the speed of the mid-altitude Rossby wave. So we'll see what happens in the equatorial beta plane. You get a similar behavior, except that you don't have the singularity. And you have 1 by y squared behavior, and it would go to infinity as y goes to 0. But if you retain ut, you avoid those problems. So you get a finite speed for the Rossby wave even at the equator. In the mid-latitudes, the consequence of ignoring terms A and B was to replace the Ekman balance by the pseudo-Ekman balance. At the equator, the Yoshida balance, and we'll see later what it means, is modified to the pseudo-Yoshida balance. That's basically what happens here. As before, there are problems near boundaries. For example, at an eastern boundary, the solutions can develop narrow coastal jets, for which Lx is of the order of 1 by alpha naught. So that approximation breaks down. You can no longer ignore term B. And these kind of problems do occur when you are talking in terms of talking of, for example, the Indian Ocean dipole. You have strong upwelling driven by longshore winds at the eastern boundary of Sumatra and Java. And you get narrow coastal currents that violate this approximation of Lx being much greater than the equatorial Rossby radius. So if you are looking at the dipole and you are looking at a solution near the eastern boundary, then you have to retain Vt. Finally, remember that the above equations are written for each vertical mode. We have basically dropped the subscript n for convenience. And just to help you recollect, u is summation over n. N goes from 1 to infinity of un, which is a function of x, y, t, and psi n, which is a function of z. Psi n is the mode shift, the eigenfunction. Okay, for each vertical mode, what do we have? Ut minus Fv plus Px equals 0. Vt plus Fu plus Py equals 0. Pt by C squared plus Ux plus Vy equals 0. We are now looking at the homogeneous equations. And our interest, as earlier, in the mid-latitudes, is to get a dispersion relation. What kind of waves exist? That's what we are looking for. Eliminating U and P yields a single equation in V. Vxxt plus Vyyt. So we have not dropped Vt now. Minus alpha squared Vt minus Vttt by C squared plus beta Vx equal to 0, where alpha is F by C and F now is beta 1. So it's a third order equation. And we want to look for solutions proportional to e power I kx minus I sigma t. Earlier we also had e power I ly. Now we can no longer do that, unlike at mid-latitudes, because F is equal to F5 even at the lowest order. Earlier we had F equals F naught plus beta 1. And at the lowest order, we could ignore the changes in F. Now we can no longer do that. At the lowest order, the changes in F are important. So all we do is substitute e power I kx minus I sigma t in these expressions. And we get this equation after dividing throughout by minus I sigma. Minus k squared v plus vyy minus beta squared v y squared by c squared and v plus sigma squared by c squared v minus k beta by sigma and v equals 0. Now this is an equation in y alone. So what we have now is an ordinary differential equation in y. If you recall, in the case of the mid-latitudes, we had used e power I ly. And what we had was an algebraic equation. Now we have a complication. You get a second order ODE in Y. But this is an equation in Y alone. And we're going to go through a fair amount of algebra now. So the rest of it is basically a manipulation of the equation. And one thing that is standard in this case is to adopt a new coordinate in the meridional direction. We replace the coordinate Y by eta, which is y into square root of beta by c. You're basically scaling y by the equilibrium velocity radius. Or eta is alpha naught into y. And therefore, eta is non-dimensional. It's because this is y divided by a length scale. So eta is non-dimensional. Eta is alpha naught y. So dou by dou y, I can write that as dou by dou eta into dou eta by dou y. Or rather, this should be dou d eta by dy. And that's equal to alpha naught. So dou by dou y is alpha naught dou by dou eta. I differentiate again, dou 2 by dou y squared is alpha naught squared dou 2 by dou eta squared, because I need the second derivative. And y is going to be replaced by eta by alpha naught wherever it occurs, and alpha naught squared is beta by c. So what do we get? Minus k squared v plus sigma squared by c squared v minus beta k by sigma v plus alpha naught squared into this operator, dou 2 by dou eta squared minus eta squared into v equal to 0. Okay, last time we had basically L squared. Now we have a differential equation that has to be solved. But just as earlier when we were deriving the LCS system of equations, we saw that making some very specific approximations for the form of vertical mixing, we were able to ensure that the Z operators had the same form in all equations. We now have this operator in brackets, dou 2 by dou eta squared minus eta squared dou v. The term in brackets suggests that we expand into eigenfunctions of dou eta, dou by dou eta eta minus eta squared into v. So what is going to be done here is to replace this operator by some eigenvalue into v, and thereby make this an algebraic equation. And then after that, we will basically look at what happens in eta. We'll solve this equation for the eigenfunctions and get the eigenvalues. We did the similar thing earlier while formulating the LCS model. We use the fact that the special choices made for the vertical mixing terms led to the same form of the Z derivatives, and we expanded into vertical normal modes. Now we expand for each vertical normal mode into meridional normal modes, because eta is the cross-equatorial coordinate. So what we will get are eigenfunctions in eta. The resulting eigenfunctions, and we'll see what they are like, are called the Hammett functions. They are related to what in many physics books is called parabolic cylinder functions, parabolic cylindrical functions. And you can map from one to the other. But the terminology used in all oceanography books is Hammett functions. And the eigenvalues are gamma L squared equals to L plus 1, where L is the index. Now, all that we are going to do now is look at this equation, which is phi L eta eta minus eta squared phi L equals minus gamma L squared phi L. We did something similar earlier in the vertical. We had a differential equation in Z, a second order differential equation, and coming from the operator, and we substituted that with minus 1 by c squared into psi n. So we have minus gamma L squared phi L. And once again, it will become clear why you have the negative sign and so on. What are the boundary conditions? Phi L has to go to 0 as eta goes to plus minus infinity. So as you go farther away from the equator, the eigenfunction must go to 0. The reason lies in a very simple fact that you are looking at a system that is equatorially trapped, and we are away from boundaries. So you really can't have a situation where you have a source of energy that is off equatorial. We want to be looking at systems forced by equatorial winds. say zonal equatorial winds, or in the case of Yamai waves, meridional winds at the equator. You don't want anything to come in from far off the equator. So there is no source of energy as you go away from the equator. You can have a source of energy at the equator, but it decays. The eigenfunctions will decay as you go away from the equator. So basically, you are looking for solutions that are equatorially trapped. And therefore, phi L has to go to 0 as eta plus goes to plus minus infinity. Now, this is some horrendous algebra, but that's all it is for the next several pages. Consider the operator, dou eta minus eta, operating on phi L. So we let capital phi equals dou eta minus eta into small phi L, operating on small phi L. So what is dou eta eta minus eta squared into capital phi, operating on capital phi? It is dou eta eta minus eta squared into dou eta minus eta phi L. We expand this. You will get dou eta 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 from these two terms. Then you get dou eta eta into eta minus eta squared dou eta plus eta cube phi. Now, look at what happens here. If you have dou eta eta of eta into q, where q is some variable, undefined variable, you will get dou eta. Then you just basically expand this out. You get q eta plus q eta plus eta into q eta eta equals 2 q eta plus eta q eta eta. And if you have written it in this form, now here, dou eta eta of eta q equals 2 q eta plus eta q eta eta. So what you get here is dou eta eta of eta q minus eta dou eta eta of q equals 2 q eta. And that implies, if you look at just the operators, dou eta 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 minus eta dou eta eta equals 2 dou eta. Okay, so eta and dou eta eta do not commute. The order of operation matters. Okay, otherwise this should have gone to 0 on the right hand side. It does not. So whether you have dou eta eta first, as you do in this term, or you have eta first, it makes a difference. Likewise, we look at what happens when you have dou eta of eta squared q. And why we are doing this will become clear, because we're just building some blocks that we are going to use repeatedly later on. Dou eta of eta squared q, again expand it out, you get 2 eta q plus eta squared, this is dou eta q. So eta squared dou eta q, that is this term, is dou eta of eta squared q minus 2 eta q. This is just rearranging these terms. And this right hand side, now I can rewrite it as dou eta eta squared minus 2 eta operating on q. So eta squared dou eta, if I look at the operators, is eta squared dou eta equals dou eta eta squared minus 2 eta. Okay, so once again, eta squared dou eta minus dou eta squared equals minus 2 eta. So eta squared and dou eta also do not commute. So eta and dou eta do not commute, and eta squared and dou eta do not commute. If this come, have a problem and I read it today. Okay, I forgot this part. Therefore, we have, what were we looking at? Dou eta minus eta squared operating on capital phi. That's equal to dou eta minus eta squared operating on dou eta minus eta operating on small phi. Now we just expand this out. We get dou eta minus eta dou eta minus 2 dou eta minus dou eta squared plus 2 eta plus eta cube operating on phi. And where did this come? From here, right? From these two boxes, yes. Okay, so these two boxes have been used to replace some of these terms, and this is what you get. Now, the reason it has been written this way is because if you look at this, you can rewrite it as, you can change the order of the operators here. Dou eta minus eta operating on dou eta minus eta operating on dou eta minus eta squared operating on phi. Okay. Minus 2 into this operator, dou eta minus eta. So we have got dou eta minus eta here in both cases operating on phi. Now, dou eta minus eta squared to phi is simply minus gamma squared into phi. That is how we have defined the Sturm Liouville problem here. So the gamma L squared is an eigenvalue, it's constant, it's taken out. So we get minus gamma L squared into dou eta into phi L minus 2 into dou eta into phi L. Now phi L is common, so that's what we have. Minus of gamma L squared plus 2 dou eta phi L. Okay, so when you have dou eta minus eta squared operating on capital phi, which is dou eta minus dou eta squared operating on dou eta minus eta into phi, operating on phi L, then this is what you get. Minus gamma L squared by minus of gamma L squared plus 2 into capital phi. So what have we done here? Dou eta minus eta squared operating on capital phi gives me dou eta minus eta squared operating on dou minus eta operating on small phi L. That's equal to minus of gamma L squared plus 2 capital phi. So if I have this operator, this operator, dou eta minus eta. Now wait a minute, this implies that phi now is an eigenfunction again, because this is what we have got. What do we have here? Dou eta minus eta squared operating on phi is equal to capital phi is equal to minus of gamma L squared plus 2 into capital phi. But this is the equation we have set up, which means that gamma L squared plus 2, or rather minus of gamma L squared plus 2, is also an eigenvalue. If gamma L squared is an eigenvalue, then minus of gamma L squared plus 2 is also an eigenvalue. Now, which implies that capital phi is an eigenfunction, and it is an eigenfunction for this eigenvalue, gamma L squared plus 2. So gamma L squared plus 2 is greater than gamma L squared. Therefore, dou eta minus eta, which is this operator that we used, is a raising operator for the eigenfunction phi L. Then you operate with dou eta minus eta on any eigenfunction phi L, you get the next eigenfunction. You basically raise the index by 1. In other words, what you're saying is capital phi that we had is nothing but some number a into phi l plus 1 of eta. So when you operate with dou eta minus eta, you essentially increase l. So you get the next eigenfunction in the series. Now we consider the operator dou eta plus eta operating on phi l. So we define capital phi is now dou eta plus eta operating on phi L. go through an algebra of the same kind, and what you will get is, again use those two boxes, you'll get dou eta eta minus eta squared operating on capital phi will give you minus of gamma l squared minus 2 capital phi. So gamma l squared minus 2 is also an eigenvalue, and you have lowered it because gamma l squared is positive and gamma l squared minus 2 is less than gamma l squared. So now we have an eigenvalue that is lower than gamma l squared. So dou eta plus eta is a lowering operator for the eigenfunction phi. So capital phi is now a into phi l minus 1 of eta. So if I know phi l, I know how to get phi l plus 1 and phi l minus 1. Basically, that is how you operate on these functions. These are Hermite functions are just one class of special functions, one kind of special functions. And in all these special functions, you have a series expansion. What you end up with is recursion relations. So if you know one of them, you can get the rest. So you have to, by some means, get one eigenfunction. If you get, say, eigenfunction for the zeroth, you get the zeroth eigenfunction, you can get all of them. So now, all we need to do is guess one eigenfunction. If we guess one correctly, then the entire set of eigenfunctions falls in place. We also know all the eigenvalues. If we get gamma naught, for example, we know all the eigenvalues because we know that we just have to take gamma naught squared plus 2 and gamma naught squared minus 2. Of course, there's a minus sign before that, but that's all we need to do. So now we're going to guess an eigenfunction, and let's say phi naught is a naught, some constant, into e power minus eta squared by 2. Note that this satisfies the boundary condition. As eta goes to plus minus infinity, this is basically the Gaussian, e power minus eta squared by 2 goes to 0. So the boundary condition is satisfied. We still don't know, however, whether the differential equation defining the eigenfunction will be satisfied, and that is what we have to check. If it is satisfied, then the job is done. Then we know that this is an eigenfunction. And if we have phi naught, we can get phi 1, we can get phi minus 1, we can get phi 2, we can get phi minus 2, and so on. We can get all of them. So what is phi naught eta? We differentiate with respect to eta. It's minus eta a naught e power minus eta squared by 2. That's simply minus eta into phi naught. Now you differentiate once again, phi naught eta eta. That's minus phi naught plus eta squared phi naught. That's it. So what is phi naught eta eta minus eta squared phi naught? You get it right from here, is equal to minus phi naught. But what is our differential equation? Phi naught eta eta minus eta squared phi naught. Phi l eta eta minus eta squared phi l is minus gamma l squared phi l. So phi naught eta eta minus eta squared phi naught equals minus phi naught equals minus gamma naught squared phi naught. And that is satisfied for gamma naught equals 1. Gamma naught squared equals 1. That's it. So because every eigenfunction satisfies this differential equation, phi l eta eta minus eta squared phi l equals minus gamma l squared phi l, and that is satisfied. So we have been correct in a choice. Now we use the raising operator. Dou eta minus eta is a raising operator. Therefore, if we define al is a naught into al prime, then phi l is al prime into dou eta minus eta power l in operating on phi naught. So if it is 1, if you are looking at phi 1, then you get a 1 prime into dou eta minus eta operating on phi naught. You operate only once. If l is equal to 2, this operator will have to be used twice, and so on, or till you reach l. So phi l is al prime to dou eta minus eta power l operating on phi naught equals al dou eta minus eta power l e power minus eta squared by 2, because al is simply a naught into al prime. And phi naught is simply a naught e power minus eta squared by 2. So we just substitute it. And that's the reason we use this prime out here. It's just to drop the prime later on. So now we have al into this operator, R L operating on e power minus eta squared by 2. Now gamma L squared is 2L plus 1. You will get that from here, because dou eta minus eta is the raising operator. The eigenvalue increases by 2 each time the raising operator is used and gamma naught equals 1. Where is 2L plus 1 come from? Okay, it rises by 2, so you have 1, then 3 for L equal to 1. For L equal to 2, you'll get 5 and so on. So gamma L squared is simply 2L plus 1. That gives you all those odd numbers, 1, 3, 5, and so on. Is that clear? Is that clear? No. This is a raising operator, right? So if you operate once, that is L equal to 1, then we saw that the eigenvalue rises by 2, right? Gamma L plus 1 is simply this was the lowering part, you get gamma L squared minus 2, and in the other case you get gamma L squared plus 2 when you use the raising operator. So if you go from phi naught to phi 1, then the raising operator will give you gamma naught squared plus 1, plus 2, which is 3. Then if you go from 3, if you go from 1 to 2, then you should go from 3 to 5 for the eigenvalue, and so on. And the way you get that is if gamma L squared is 2L plus 1. You get all the odd numbers. So for 0, you get 1. For L equal to 1, you get 2. 3. For L equal to 2, you get 5, and so on. So it's 2L plus 1, because dou eta minus eta is the raising operator. The eigenvalue increases by 2 each time the raising operator is used, and gamma naught equal to 1. Since the operator dou eta minus eta can be applied to e power minus eta squared by 2, eigenfunctions exist for L greater than or equal to 0. Now, remember that you can keep differentiating this function. That is the remarkable feature of the exponential function. It's unlike a polynomial. At some point, the polynomial will lead to a constant, and then you do more, you get 0. So there's a truncation that comes, but not with the exponential function. You can keep differentiating it. So for L greater than or equal to 0, all eigenfunctions will exist.
So we have gamma squared equals gamma naught squared equals to 1 for this eigenfunction. That is not unique, that eigenfunction.
I will pick one.
So if we take different eigenfunction, then we can...
What do you mean different eigenfunction, eigenvalue? Why will you take a different eigenvalue?
Different eigenfunction.
Why will you take a different eigenfunction? This is the eigenfunction. It's defined by the differential equation. I have no liberty in picking the eigenfunction.
Yes, but then that may not be unique.
If it is not unique, then the differential equation must have multiple solutions. This differential equation is known to have a solution, and it is known that the solution is unique.
There is boundary condition.
What boundary condition?
So it must go to zero when it has.
So what about the boundary condition?
Boundary conditions makes it unique.
No, boundary condition does not make it unique. What makes it unique is that this differential equation has a solution, and the solution is unique. So if you have got any solution, it is the solution. There cannot be any other solution. You have to prove that the solution exists and that the solution is unique. Once you have done that, you find a solution and it is the solution. And whatever it is, it has to satisfy the boundary condition. That is how you know that there is no other solution possible. So you don't have to do anything. If you have guessed and guessed right, the job is done. So since these exponential functions can be differentiated any arbitrary number of times, eigenfunctions will exist for L greater than or equal to 0, because what we have used here is the raising operator. Now what happens if you go the other way? Are there eigenfunctions for L less than 0? We check by applying the lowering operator, which is dou eta plus eta. So what happens? Pi minus 1 is A minus 1 dou eta plus eta operating on phi naught. A minus 1 to dou eta plus eta operating on e power minus eta squared by 2. Because there's an A naught. So you can you should take this as A minus 1 prime and then multiply A minus 1 prime by A naught and set that to A minus 1. But I think that's been done away with here because it turns out it doesn't matter. So you have A minus 1 multiplying in square brackets. What do you get from here? Minus eta. Dou eta operating on e power minus eta squared by 2 gives minus eta into e power minus eta squared by 2 plus eta into e power minus eta squared by 2. That cancels out. You get 0. So phi L equal to 0 for all less L less than 0. So the lowest order eigenfunction is for L equal to 0. There are no eigenfunctions existing for negative values of L. They are identically 0 basically. So these eigenfunctions, which are the solution to the differential equation dou eta eta minus eta squared operating on phi L equal to minus gamma L squared phi L, are called Hermite functions. And now we know what those eigenfunctions are. We know all the eigenfunctions, we know all the eigenvalues because we have guessed one and we know the recursion relation. Or rather, we know the raising and lowering operators. We rewrite phi L equal to AL dou eta minus eta power L e power minus eta squared by 2 as follows. Phi L equal to AL dou eta minus eta power L minus 1 open brace bracket dou eta minus eta e power eta squared by 2 to e power minus eta squared. Now this is e power minus eta squared by 2, but here it's been separated out. And this is a pretty nasty piece of algebra. It took me some time to convince myself that it is correct. You take dou eta minus eta operating on e power eta squared by 2 into q, where q is any variable. And later we will set it to e power minus eta squared. You just differentiate term by term. You get eta into, first differentiate this term, operating, I mean that is dou eta operating on e power eta squared by 2. You get eta e power eta squared by 2 q plus e power eta squared by 2 q eta, and then you get minus eta e power eta squared by 2 q. So these two terms cancel out and you're left with dou eta minus eta operating on e power eta squared by 2 into q equals e power eta squared by 2 into q eta. Now this is all that's done. Now this is exploited. Therefore phi L equals AL into open square bracket dou eta minus eta power L minus 1 into e power eta operating on e power eta squared by 2 close square bracket into d by d eta of e power minus eta squared. That is q eta. So this relation that we have derived is simply exploited here. And then you just keep shifting the power from here. That is, the L was here and you had no power for this operator. It was d by d eta power 0 of e power minus eta squared. Now we have brought it to d by d eta power 1 of e power minus eta squared. We just keep shifting the power out from dou eta minus eta to this d by d eta. So if you continue doing that, you get phi L equals L into open square bracket dou eta minus eta power L minus 2 into e power eta squared by 2 close square bracket another square bracket d 2 by d eta squared of e power minus eta squared close square bracket. And this we repeat L times. When you do that, you will get L to e power eta squared by 2 to d L by d eta power L operating on e power minus eta squared. So the derivatives have been shifted out here. And now you know if you want any eigenfunction you can get that. This is called a generating function. So each of these special functions has a generating function. Most of the time what you will do is use something different. You will use what's called a recursion relation. You will simply compute one eigenfunction and then just use the recursion relations to get the rest of them. That's done for all these special functions. Now I'm not going to go into these details, but these are worked out in the notes and I strongly urge you to go over them. You can show all these things. The eigenfunctions are orthogonal. They must be because they are the solutions to a Sturm-Liouville problem. That means integral from minus infinity to plus infinity, phi l prime, d eta equal to 0 for l not equal to l prime. We got something similar for the eigenfunctions in the case of the vertical normal modes. That's why they are normal modes, meridional normal modes now. The eigenfunctions form a complete set because they are the solutions to a Sturm-Liouville problem. This is a complete solution that you are getting here. Eigenfunctions are generally normalized, and we can normalize in this case by setting AL to one of these two forms. You can either have AL equals 1 by square root of 2 power L into L factorial and square root of pi, or AL equals minus 1 power L divided by 2 power L L factorial square root of pi power half. Okay. So either of these normalizations is possible. And the use of the raising and lowering operators, this you can show, leads to the following recursion relations. Phi L eta equals, which basically is d by d eta of phi L. Phi L eta equals minus under root of L plus 1 by 2, phi L plus 1, plus under root of L by 2, phi L minus 1. And eta phi L equals under root of L plus 1 by 2, phi L plus 1, plus under root of L by 2, phi L minus 1. So you can see that if I subtract one from the other, this operator is dou by dou eta, and this is eta. So if I take dou by dou eta minus eta operating on phi L, I basically get minus 2 into under root L plus 1, phi L plus 1. And that is simply minus square root of 2 minus under root of 2 into L plus 1, phi L plus 1. So this phi L minus 1 term will disappear. So I can basically get all the eigenfunctions. This is how you get them. You can either use a generating equation and keep generating eigenfunctions, but that's normally not done. You get one or two and then you get the rest by using these recursion relations. But the solution is now more complicated. Earlier we had very simple e power ikx and e power ily behavior. So you had the harmonics, cosines and sines in the both zonal and meridional directions in the mid-latitude case in the interior. Now you don't. In the case of the equatorial beta plane, you get e power ikx is still fine, but you get Hermite functions in the y direction. Now these are just some more uses of these recursion relations. If you say QL and index L on eta Q and Q eta L, if they are the Hermite expansion coefficients of the functions Q of eta, eta Q and Q eta respectively, that is Q of eta equals sigma L equals 0 to infinity. Remember that the negative values are gone. They're identically 0, so it doesn't matter. Sigma L equal to 0 to infinity, QL, phi L of eta. Eta Q equals L, sigma L equals 0 to infinity, eta Q of L, phi L of eta, and so on. Then you can write down recursion relations for eta Q of L and Q eta of L. Now we're just going to write down and plot the first three Hermite functions, that is the first three meridional modes on an equatorial beta plane. Phi L is, this is a generating function, phi L equals minus 1 power L divided by under root of 2 power L, L factorial square root of pi into e power eta squared by 2 into dL by d eta power L of e power minus eta squared. So phi naught, L equal to 0 implies you get e power minus eta squared from here. So you will get e power minus eta squared by 2, L equal to 0 So 2 par L is 1, L factorial is 1, minus 1 par L is 1. So you get pi power 1 by 4 in the denominator and 1 in the numerator. So phi naught is 1 by pi power 1 by 4, 3 power minus eta squared by 2. L equal to 1, differentiate once, and you work that out, you will get minus 1 power L, so minus 1 power N. This is 2 power 1, 1 factorial is 1, so this is 2, square root of pi, and you get minus 1, you will get minus 2 eta, e power minus eta squared by 2, so that remains the same, and the minus sign will cancel this minus sign, you get eta, that is out here, and you get 2, so that will get cancel out partly with the square root of 2 from here, so you get pi 1 equals eta root 2 by pi power 1 by 4 into e power minus eta squared by 2. So the phi naught is symmetric about the equator, and phi 1 is antisymmetric. You have eta multiplying e power minus eta squared by 2, antisymmetric function. But this Gaussian, the exponential function, will always go to 0 much faster than eta can go to infinity. So it will still be bounded as eta goes to plus minus infinity. Similarly, you differentiate twice, you get phi L equal to 2, phi 2 equals 2 eta squared minus 1 by root 2 pi power 1 by 4, e power minus eta squared by 2. This is also symmetric. Note that phi L tends to 0 as eta goes to plus minus infinity, and that is a boundary condition satisfied. So that's what the first three Hermit functions look like. This is phi naught in blue, symmetric about the equator. Phi 1 is antisymmetric. It has a zero crossing at eta equals 0, that's at the equator. It's positive on the eta greater than 0 side, that's the northern hemisphere, negative on the southern side. And that's because of the way we have gone about normalizing. Phi 2 is negative at the equator and symmetric. So you have two more lobes here, and you have two zero crossings because you have zero crossings wherever eta squared is equal to half. So wherever eta is plus minus 1 by root 2, you get pi going to 0. So this is what the first three eigenfunctions look like. So basically, the eigenfunctions will wiggle more and more as you increase the meridional movement. So this is what happens on an equatorial beta plane. Now, that's all I have for today. Tomorrow let's meet again at 2:45 and I'll look at what are the free waves that can exist on the equatorial beta plane. I don't think I'll be able to finish it tomorrow. So we will continue then on Monday. I'm not going to be able to take class on Friday. Fine. These notes are available with you, and I think there's no other book. You have to walk through the algebra. I have done that twice, and even today I struggled. I wasn't sure how some of those things come in. I have to think my way through that. So unless you work them out, it's not going to get you anywhere. In particular you, because you have to write the exams. Others just have to come and listen. Okay.
Tomorrow you have two classes?
Only one. 2:45. Because at 4 o'clock I think Dr. Banagar is taking that lecture. And I want to attend it, irrespective of what you are doing. So, we meet tomorrow at 2:45, only one class. See you then.